Hey, fellow problem solvers, Colfax Math here. Today I'm going to go over a practice math exam for the Army Aviation Test. It's a SIFT test, S-I-F-T. There's a lot riding on this test. You can't take it as many times as you want. You can only take it twice, so you really need to prepare. What I'd highly recommend you do is have a notebook and pencil in front of you. Do the problems before I do them, and then watch how I do them. Test is provided by ASVAB Tutoring. I'm gonna put a link in the description to them, and you might wanna go to them and check out more resources. Doing well on any standardized math exam is pretty similar. It's really all about practice, recognizing the problems, recognizing what you're being asked for, and doing a lot of practice problems so you get good at them and you're good at doing it in a time fashion, and also learning some of the tips and tricks in those problems. So I'm gonna go over that in this practice test right here. If you have any questions on this, please post them in the comments and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Okay, again, if you're looking for a link to more resources, it's right here, officers.asvabtutoring.com. Let's jump right into it. So let's go ahead and get started. When the temperature is 20 degrees Celsius, what is the Fahrenheit? And then here's the formula. So it's telling you it is 20 degrees Celsius. So that 20 just gets plugged in right there. Every one of these problems you should be able to do without a calculator. So F is equal to 9/5 times C, which we know is 20, plus 32. It's gonna work out pretty well on multiplying fractions. So 5 goes into here once, 5 goes into here 4 times. Now I know Fahrenheit is equal to 9 times 4, 36, plus 32 is 68. And I can see that's going to be answer C right here, degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, problem number 2, find the total thickness of 2 pieces of wood if one is 5/16 and one is 7/8. So right here, before I even start the problem, I recognize I'm adding fractions. I know I need a common denominator. I have 5/16 plus 7/8. That common denominator is gonna be 16. I have to multiply this by 1. So 2/2 is the equivalent of 1, so I don't affect the value of it. That 2 right there is gonna give me a 16 here, and that's what I want, so I have that common denominator. Now I have 5/16 plus 7 times 2, 14. 16ths, add across the top, 19, keep the bottom, position the same, 19/16. That answer is not over there, so I gotta turn it into a mixed number. 16 goes into 19 one time with 3 left over, so it's 1 3/16, and I see that's answer D right here. Problem number 3, John is paid $26 for 8 hours of work. How much would he be paid for 37 hours? So this is a rate problem. We might as well figure out the rate per hour and then multiply that by 37. $26 for 8 hours, I'm gonna do 1 divided by the other. So the way I do that, it's like a fraction falling over. 8 goes into 26. Goes in there 3 times, 8 times 3, 24, 2. 8 goes into 20 twice to give me 16. 40, bring down to 0, 8 goes into 40 5 times, so 325 an hour. So he makes 325 per hour times a total of 37 hours. So I'm gonna multiply that by 37. Then I'm gonna do long multiplication here, 7 times 5, 35, carry the 3. 14, 15, 16, 17, carry the 1, 21, 22. Got a placeholder here. 3 times 5, 15, carry the 1, 6 plus 1, 7. 3 times 3, 9. Now I add straight down 5. 7 and 5 is 12, carry the 1. 10, carry the 1, it's gonna give me 12. Now that I have it all multiplied together, I see I have a decimal place over 1, 2. So I bring my decimal place over 1, 2, and I get 1, 20, 25. See if that even makes sense. 26 bucks for 8 hours, right? So 8 goes into 37. Let's just average it, you know, 4 or 5 times. So it should be 4 or 5 times the amount of that, which it is. So that seems to make sense. All right, number 4 here. A cylinder of base 8 square feet. So the area of this base is 8. Area of a circle, pi r squared, already telling you it's 8. It's filled 1/4 of the way with water. So it only goes up about 1/4 of the way. The overall H, we don't know. The overall height, we don't know. Rectangular tank, a base 2 by 3, also filled with the same volume of water. The height of both is the same, so this height is the same as that, so we're going to use the same letter height. What is the ratio of empty space of the cylinder to rectangular tank? So there's a ton going on here. It's a hard problem. We got volumes, we got ratios, full versus empty. There's a lot of pieces here. So we know the volume of this whole cylinder is base area times height. So the volume of this is 8H. I don't want the whole volume. I actually want the empty space. So a quarter of 8, or a quarter of the total volume is 2. So the volume of the bottom part is 2H. And the top part that's not filled, the other 3/4, is 6H. So the volume of this cylinder right here that is not filled is 6H. So the amount in the cylinder is 2H plus the 6H. So it's filled with 2H. So that means this right here is going to be 2H if the volume of water in both are the same. So the amount that's not filled right here is 4H, right? So this thing right here is filled with 2H because this thing right here is filled with 2H. The volume that's not filled here is 6H. The volume that's not filled here going back is 4H. And then we're looking at the ratio of empty space of the cylinder, 6H, to the rectangular tank. What's not filled here is 4H. So I'm a ratio of 6H divided by 4H. My heights will cancel, and this will reduce to 3/2. So that ratio is right here. Answer B. That is a hard problem. You got to kind of decode all those words, understand volumes, ratios. And then some of the tricks in here is you're not talking about the volume filled, but rather the volume not filled. Another trick here is that it says the same height, and that's how you could use the same variable H in both. Number 5, a car depreciates in value 10% a year. What's the value after 3 years? So there's going to be a few different steps here. Let's say this thing starts at 100%. That's at the beginning. A year later, it's 90% of that value. So I take 100%, multiply it by 0.9, right? 90% converted to a decimal. I move it over 1, 2 to get 0.9. 100 times 0.9 is 90%. So that's after 1 year. I do that again for the second year, 90 times 0.9, 9 times 9 is 81, so I end at 81%. So at the end of the second year, it's 81%. And then 81% times 0.9 again. Well, 8 times 9 is 72, so it's going to be 72 and a little bit. Let me check over at my answers. There's only one answer above 72, so it has to be answer D, 72.9%. Number 6, find the radius of a sphere that has a volume of 96 pi. This one you just have to know the equation for a sphere, the volume in it, is 4/3 pi r cubed. So I have 4/3 pi r cubed, and that's going to be equal to the volume given, 96 pi. So now I have an equation, the general equation for volume of a sphere, equal to what's given. That cubic feet are just units. So now what I got to do is isolate that variable r, so I got to get r by itself. So first thing I'll do is I'll divide both sides by pi, right? This and this will cancel, and that'll give me 4/3 r cubed, and this will cancel, so I have 96. Now I got to get rid of that 4/3. I could divide by 4/3 or just multiply by the reciprocal 3/4. This is going to cancel with this, this with this, giving me r cubed by itself. If I do that to the left side, I also have to do it to the right side. So I'm going to multiply this by 3/4. So 4, this is a 4 here, 4 goes into 96. I could do 96 cut in half, 45, 48. 48 cut in half is 24. So 4 goes into here once, into here 24 times. Now I have 3 times 24, 72. So I have 72 on the right side. Everything on the left side is canceled. I have RQ equals 72. I'm getting closer. I'm looking at my answers. I don't see it there, so I'm going to have to keep working on solving it. This is a cube root. Something times itself will equal 72. Because what I really have to do here is I got to take the cube root of r cubed. That'll cancel that. If I do that to the left side, I have to do it to the right side. So I got to take the cube root of 72. I'm looking at my answers. There's no decimal approximation. They're all in square root form. So I got to simplify it. 72 is made up of a 9 and an 8. And then a 9 is a 3 and a 3. An 8 is a 4 and a 2. Or a 2, a 2, and a 2. Right? 2 times 2 is 4, times 2 is 8. So I could see I could cube root that one. There's no cube root for that one, so it stays in. So r is equal to the cube root of 8. Actually, let me do this. The cube root of 8 times the cube root of 9. This right here is 2 times 2 times 2, so this one works. So r is equal to 2. This thing turns into a 2. There's no solution for that one. No integer solution. So my solution is 2 cube root of 9 feet. It's a singular unit because we're talking about a radius, a length right there. Pretty hard problem. First you have to know the equation for a sphere. Then you have to isolate the variable r. There's two problems right there. Then you have to be able to figure out the cube root of 72 in simple radical form. So there's a lot of steps on that one. Number 7, the floor area of a Navy warehouse is 250 by 200. So we're looking for air. The weight of the floor can hold 4,000 tons. What's the maximum, say, floor per square foot? As I look down here, I'm just going to check this out. These are all pounds. So I got a unit conversion here. I got area. And then I also have rate. So let's figure out the area of this. 2 times 25. So I'm just going to do 2 times 25 is 50. Then I got these two zeros and that zero. So I'm going to add those on there, and I'm going to keep them kind of together to separate by a comma. So I have 50,000 square foot. I look over here. These are all pounds. You also need to know that there are 2,000 pounds to the ton. So I have 2,000 pounds times 4,000 tons. I'm just going to multiply 2 times 4 to get 8. Then I'll keep track of my zeros. I got 3 zeros there. 3 zeros there. And then what do I want to know? I want to know the load per square foot. So that means I'm going to have to take this 8 million divided by the square footage of 50,000. So I got the 8 million pounds, 4,000 tons times 2,000 pounds per ton. And then I'm going to divide that by the area. Those three will cancel with those three. That one will cancel with that one. And I'm left with 800 divided by 5. So 5 goes into 800. It goes into 5 goes into 8 one times. 30 left over. Goes in there 6 to give me 30. Bring down to 0. So how many pounds per square foot? It's 160 pounds per square foot right there. Number 8. A is greater than 3, so I'm just going to write that out. A is greater than 3. Which of the following is the greatest? So I got to kind of work with my answers and see what makes sense. I think the first thing I'm going to do is just pick a value for A that holds true there. So I'm just going to pick 4 and see what that looks like. So let's just say A is equal to 4. If A is equal to 4, I have 3 fourths, 4 thirds. A is 4, 4 plus 1 is 5 thirds, and then down here, 3 over 4 plus 1, 3 fifths. So this right here and this right here are both less than 1, and I could see no matter what I pick for A, if A was a million, any value greater than 3, this is going to be a teeny fraction, same with that, so those aren't going to work. Now, if A were a different number besides 4, like a really large number, it would still be a large number plus 1. It would always be greater than that no matter what. So my correct answer here is answer C. Okay, number 9, the area of a square in the diagram below is 36. So area is equal to 36. Area is base times height. And then I know they're the same because it's a square, square inches. So this is 6 by 6. What's the area of the circle in the square? Well, if this is 6, right, because this is 6, this is half of that, the radius is half of that at 3. Area of a circle is pi r squared. I take that 3 and I square it to get 9 times pi. I look over at my answers, they're all exact value. There's no decimal approximations. There's my answer right there, 9 pi square inches. The unit square is because I have inches squared. Before I do problem number 10, I think I'm going to end it after 10. Even though I have 20 problems here, I'll split it into 2 videos. I don't want this video to get too long. If I can make a couple recommendations, make sure you have a notebook out and you keep track of all the tests you're doing and all your work and make notes to yourself of important equations to remember. Do the problems before I do them and then watch how I do them. If you're new to the channel, think about subscribing. And if you have any questions, please post them in the comments and I'd be happy to answer them as soon as I can. You want to mark up the test as much as you can so that you don't make any careless mistakes. And if it's a computer test, when you take it, you want notepaper in front of you and keep track of all your notes in there as well. So when you go back to check your work, you don't have to start all over again. You can look at your work. So number it, stay organized, and kind of look for the tips and tricks, glancing down to the answers before you go all the way through the problem. And that might help you to decode what they're actually asking. Okay, the hypotenuse of a right triangle. A lot of properties of right triangles, all trig. Most important property, though, is Pythagorean theorem, whose legs are 6 and 8. You might not recognize that, but that's going to be a 3, 4, 5 triangle. So if this were 3, this is 4, this would be 5. Each one of those is doubled, so this would be 10. If you don't know 3, 4, 5, you could always use the Pythagorean theorem and say one leg squared plus the other leg squared is equal to hypotenuse squared. 36 plus 64 is equal to c squared. C squared is equal to 100. Square root of both sides is 10. It's actually plus or minus 10, but you're talking about the length of a side, so it's only going to be 10. There's your answer there. Well, I sure hope this helped. I encourage you to keep studying, keep doing as many problems as you can. Doing well on these tests is all about practicing the problems and recognizing what they're asking for. Do some review. That'll go really far on doing well on this SIFT Aviation for the Army test. Thank you for watching.